Good afternoon, everyone. I hope everybody's ready to sit down and learn a little bit about Neutron. I am. And so we'll see if we can't figure it all out together this afternoon. I'd like to spend a little time looking at probably the number one question. My name is Phil Hopkins, and I work for Rackspace, obviously, with a slide up there. And I get to travel around the world teaching OpenStack. And one of the most frequent questions that happens is, well, I got this all OpenStack up, but how do I make the networking piece work? Or I spun up a VM. How many get this problem? I spun up a VM, and I look at it, and it didn't get an IP. Now what do I do? Or I tried to ping out. What do I do? So we're going to spend the next 40 minutes. Now, this is a distillation of a three-day class, so we clearly aren't going to be able to do 3 days' worth of work in 40 minutes, but we're going to take a distillation of that and look at how to troubleshoot Neutron problems. And so let's take a few seconds to start this process here. And the whole idea is we're going to look at how to troubleshoot Neutron problems. And if the gods of presentations will smile upon me today, we're actually going to do this in a demo form as opposed to slides, which will be hopefully more interesting. If they don't, I have the backup with the slides here. So let's talk about the troubleshooting process. One of the things before we get started jumping into how to troubleshoot Neutron is to talk about how to troubleshoot. More problems I see is we see somebody come up, post a problem on the IRC, or I've worked with people time and time again troubleshooting. They see a couple symptoms, or somebody tells them this is broken. They think about it for a second. They're immediately jumping in, try to fix something. They'll tweak this. Well, that didn't fix it. So I jump over and tweak this. And in 5 minutes, you've got a system that's almost, they've tweaked so many knobs, there's no way of getting it back to the beginning. And this troubleshooting process is very important. It implies you need a couple things. One is you need an understanding of how the system works that you're trying to troubleshoot. If you don't know that, you need to go read the great manual, because you got to understand what it should be before you can differentiate between what it's doing right now and where it's not doing the things it should be. So it's taking that time to understand the technology, to understand what's going on behind the process, and then collect data. You have a customer typically, or somebody come in, or problems reported, you get some terse thing, you need to go investigate. Does it really, can you simulate that? Can you get the results that they were getting? If so, what does that imply? Have you looked at your system, gathered data about it, looked down into, well, if that's happening, what other things should be happening to see where things are working and where things aren't, and find out where that disconnect is? It's only at that point, when I've gathered enough data, can I then start looking at considering what could cause that and what could be the solutions. Again, so many people jump in and start twisting knobs before they fully understand what's going on, what's going wrong. And you need to take time to gather that data. So we're going to do that today in a problem I've set up here where the VM doesn't get an IP. What do I do? In a few minutes, we'll look at that. But it's getting that data that we have, that background, so we can then consider the causes and the solutions. Based on that, we should be able to go say, I think it's this. Then we should gather more data to see if it appears to be that whatever it is not working right. And only then do we go say, okay, I think I've convinced myself that's a problem. If I tweak this knob, it should fix it. We go tweak the knob and it's still broke. What do we do next? Well, the first thing we should do is set the knob back where it was and go collect more data. I can't tell you how many times I've made that same mistake. Well, if it's not that, I think it's over here. And we break it so bad that takes hours to fix a simple problem. So it's going through this problem-solving process, but gathering data. Spend the bulk of your time gathering data. If you do that, you'll find fixing the problems relatively straightforward. Well, we get those problems, we've gathered data, and we still don't know what's going on. And in OpenStack Neutron, the place to go is the IRC channel. There's a lot of help, there's a lot of folks willing to help out there, and if you've really read the manual, you've really tried to understand the problem and still stuck in a problem, there are a lot of very knowledgeable people that will be there to help you. So again, remember this process. Take a chart like this, etch it in your brain, and remember, gather data, gather data, gather data before you ever go into starting twisting knobs. So let's talk about OpenStack networking. And I put up this big chart here. This is one I want us to look at and spend a few minutes on, because this is a block diagram of how Neutron actually wires things up on the compute node. And if you'll go to, I think it's the administration manual, there's a slightly different view of this, but it's a similar type document that you can go look at to see what the flow is. And we can see that in this case, we've got three VMs and two tenants up here. So two tenants on two separate networks, and the VMs plugged in here. In this case, the VMs are going into Open vSwitch, but there's a bunch of, what are these little blocks between the VM and Open vSwitch? Well, something changed in OpenStack, so it went from fulsome to grizzly and on, and what that was is the ability to engage something called Neutron Security Group. Neutron Security Group rules are applied on the compute node between the VM and Open vSwitch. Well, in fulsome, the VMs were plugged straight into Open vSwitch. And if you understand the Linux stack at all, user space program plugged into user space program never hits IP tables. And so we needed to cause the traffic to go through the kernel, local kernel IP tables, so we could filter at that point, so we could control data going in and out of VM. Specifically, we wanted to make sure that if some bad person was on a VM, they couldn't do things like spoof their MAC address. Well, if I filter it anywhere but right in that path between Open vSwitch and the VM, they potentially could do bad things and do bad things to that machine. So we added something here, the tap interface being plugged into a Linux bridge, and that Linux bridge then having a vEth pair plugged on one side of the Linux bridge into the Open vSwitch process. What that then forces is all the traffic coming from each VM to go through IP table rules. And the first thing the Neutron Security Group rules do is filter that traffic. In specific, they will filter the traffic, making sure that the traffic to and from the VM is addressed to the MAC address that OpenStack thinks that VM should have, and the IP address that OpenStack thinks that VM should have. So if you on your VM go changing the IP address or trying to spoof your MAC address, you're going to guarantee the traffic is going to go off that VM into the IP table rules and hit a drop rule. It's not going to go anywhere. In other words, don't do that. It's one of the things that we need to do for security. So what happens if we have a normal traffic flow comes out of VM through Linux bridge, through the IP table rules and Open vSwitch. In Open vSwitch, we have, in a normal configuration, we'll have the integration bridge, which all the ports from the VMs plug into, and that's connected with a tap connection, if you please, between that and either a tunnel bridge or a bridge for VLANs. I'm showing one for GRE tunnels. If we were doing VXLANs, it would look just like this, look very similar to this if we're doing VLANs. But that data, to keep the network separate as it comes in from VMs, gets tagged with a VLAN tag inside Open vSwitch. So when that data comes in for a network, and if you notice on your right, or your left, my right, the two VMs that are on the same network come in, and their data, their packets, are tagged with a VLAN tag that is calculated on the fly as Open vSwitch starts, as the Neutron plug-in Open vSwitch agent starts up. It'll calculate that based on all the networks it sees in it. In this case, it was given on the on my right, your left, it was given VLAN tag 2 and VLAN tag 3 for the other one. So as that data comes into that Open vSwitch ports, it gets a VLAN tag, gets put down into the bridge tunnel. Bridge tunnel will have flow tables, and the principal thing those flow tables will do is encapsulate the packets, but it'll give a GRE tunnel key based on the network. So each network will get a different GRE tunnel key. This keeps all the network data separate. It comes out of that, and it will go into the network and eventually should connect to the network node on the other end. Network node, if you notice, there's lots of colors here. It looks very simple. It'll come in, to the bridge tunnel. Flow tables, now we'll strip off the GRE tunnel key or VXLAN ID or the VLAN ID, tag it with an internal open vSwitch VLAN, and eventually that'll go to the integration bridge, and based on its internal VLAN tag, will go to the proper either DHCP namespace or router namespace for that network. And we can see in this case, we have both of those. On this, we have VLAN tag 2 for one network and its DHCP namespace, and we have one for the other network with the other for the other namespace for the other network. Its VLAN tag guarantees to keep that network traffic separate. For the DHCP requests, now, by the way, does anybody understand how a DHCP request goes? What exactly happens there? Because it's this process, we even need to know the bottom layer packet things that happen to understand how things are handled in Neutron. Well, if you understand a DHCP request, the VM does what? Sends out a broadcast. And we won't, so it sends out a broadcast packet that'll eventually be received by that DNS mass process. And what it will do is it will send a unicast packet back from that broadcast that is a IP address offer. It says, I got your request, I see your MAC address, here's a free IP address for you. It sends that back. Are we done yet? No. The VM will come back and say, okay, another broadcast packet. It says, I see this, I want this IP address. It sends it back to the DNS mass processor, your DHCP server. The DHCP server gets that request packet now from its offer, and it sends an acknowledgement, a unicast packet back that will cause the VM to say, okay, I now have my IP address. I can set that up, and I can go with that. So we actually have four packets being exchanged. It's important to understand that. It's also important to realize that two of those packets are multicast, those coming from the VM in this case, and the returns from the DHCP server are unicast. Now, any other communication starts with what? I want to ping another machine. We send out an ICMP request, right? No, actually, the first thing we do is we send out an ARP request, which is, again, a broadcast, and then we'll get an ARP response back. And then we can start sending, and the ARP request is a broadcast, the response is a unicast, then we start sending out unicast ICMP requests. That's very important, because as we look at the flow tables, how the flow tables work in Open vSwitch, we need to understand exactly how this process works. I want to make another couple of comments here, too. As we troubleshoot, how many still use ifconfig to go find the IP address of your machine? Okay, take your hand that's up there and say, don't do that. If you haven't noticed in the man pages, ifconfig is deprecated. With the advent of the IP Route 2 package, there's a number of commands that are deprecated. Ifconfig, route, netstat, you know, all these commands we're all familiar with and we love to use, those are all deprecated. And there's a set of commands, even the ARP command, is replaced by some in the IP set of commands. In this case, you need to understand IP address, IP route, there's this IP network namespace, and if since we use network namespaces in Neutron heavily when you're using overlapping IPs, you have to understand how network namespaces work, and so you're gonna have to use the IP commands in this, so you have to get used to that. And the last one is IP neighbor, which is the replacement for the ARP command. Now, if you haven't used it, one of the nice things about IP neighbor that shows that the ARP command does not show is it shows whether this is an active or stale route. Now, how long does a typically, now we can tweak it and there's other things that vary it, but typically I send an ARP request, I get it back. How long before that ARP request by default in Linux kernel before it goes stale? Anybody know how long that is? Well, I'll give you the answer. It's 60 seconds by default. And if it goes stale, then I need to contact that. What happens there? It's understanding Neutron, troubleshooting Neutron. You need to know how packet flow works and what happens in the Linux kernel, because it's through this process we figure out what's going on. And if you don't understand these basics, you're going to trip up with the fact of how the flow tables work and what happens. Well, by the way, if that gets stale, it'll send the packet out to the end because it still sees it. And then immediately thereafter, it will send the ARP request also. So a route goes stale, it's going to try to communicate, but it's also going to send an ARP request. That's very important because as we get into that. Let me also mention the fact that IP tables is something critical to know in troubleshooting Neutron and know how to use it. A couple of the options that we tend not to use, I have a dash dash V, that should be just a dash V. Dash V is very helpful because it gives the packet statistics for every packet that matched that rule, or so it goes through that rule. So we can actually use a watch command to see how packets are progressing through the various IP table chains if we suspect that's where it's being lost. Line numbers is also helpful because it gives an order, number order of the various rules within a chain that makes it. Again, other commands, the ping, the host, all these commands are important for us to remember because we're going to need to use those in troubleshooting Neutron. Also, if you're not familiar with Open vSwitch, you need to spend some time familiarizing yourself with Open vSwitch. Get it up and running and use these commands to see what kind of data we can get out to see what's going on inside Open vSwitch. Because most of Neutron implementations end up using Open vSwitch, unless you're using Linux Bridge or there's a few others, but most of us are using Open vSwitch in our implementations today. The VSCTL command, the show to see the basic configuration, the OFCTL, the dump flows, so we can see the flows in there. We can also use show to see, you'll find that in VSCTL, it gives us names on our ports, but in the flows it uses port numbers. Well, we end up having to go that mapping back and forth. So the OFCTL show on the particular bridge we want to see is very critical to get that mapping so we can figure out what data is going where. And then the appctl allows us to also do dump flows. But the other nice thing about it is the FDB show will allow us to see what MAC addresses the various bridges have learned. So the integration bridge, for example, in the case we showed up there where there's two VMs side by side plugging into the same network, that traffic can go straight into Open vSwitch and immediately on one port, immediately out the other one when it's going from VM to VM in that same machine. It doesn't have to go through Open vSwitch and the flow tables out the GRE tunnel back in. It's just going to get routed around. And part of it is because of the way Open vSwitch learns the MAC addresses on the same VLAN. So again, some of the information. Lastly, my voice is struggling today, so please forgive me. And lastly, Open vSwitch allows something called port spanning or port mirroring, depending on what your background it is. It allows us to echo the data from any one port, either the data going into the port or out of it, to another port. What we can do is create a VETH pair, plug in an Open vSwitch, mirror certain ports to that, and use TCP dump on that mirror to see what data is going into ports. Another tool in our toolbox to see what's going on in Open vSwitch. Because this is the black box that we tend to get confused with and not understanding what's going on. So it's used to mirror traffic, it says, selected ports, and is very useful for debugging. And let's get into then the flow tables in Open vSwitch. A change happened in Open vSwitch in the flow tables as we went into the Grizzly on, or maybe in Havana, I forget which one. And prior to that, we just used everything in table zero. The problem with doing that is that sometimes we had to populate that with all the return paths. And that could get very complicated. And I'll explain what I mean there. What we now have is the flows are divided in a bunch of different tables. And depending on what happens here, if we look at the rules, what we care about is this right before actions. If you notice in the very first rule where it says duration 57594, the line below that, the next one, it says import 3. It's going to take import 3 and resubmit that into that resubmit comma 2. So that's going to go to cable two, table 2. And if we see the next line is going to resubmit that to table 1. As well, we have a couple more table 2s. Table 2 is the next one. Packets are either going to go to table 1 or table 2. Let's hit table 1. Table 1 is basically packets coming from outside open vSwitch, coming in from a GRE tunnel, came in a GRE tunnel, and it needs to go to a VM typically. Rule 1 is going to look at, and if you recognize what that rule is, that first rule is going to match on broadcast packets. So any outside broadcast packet is going to match rule 1, and that's going to get resubmitted to table 21. The second rule is going to match on unicast packets and is going to get resubmitted to table 20. So remember this, table 21, we're going to get to in just a second, does broadcast packets. Table 20 will handle unicast packets. The packets that came in from VMs get injected into table 2 here. And again, if you notice these packets from the VMs, and let me see, I may have the, go to table 20. If you notice this, we'll get submitted, this says table 20. This is going to go to table 10. Actually, let me correct an error on the screen. I have table 20 and 21 being, tables 1 and 2. Table 2 is actually from the outside. Table 1 was from the VMs. Now, they both go to table 20 and 21, and I just caught an error on my slide that I've got to get fixed here. Because the packets coming from the outside are all going to go either to, actually, they're going to all go to table 10. And table 10 is an important table that got added to Open vSwitch. And I'll talk about what it does in just a second. Tables coming from the outside are going to go into table 10, and they're going to have, based on their tunnel key, if you notice, it's going to match on a tunnel ID. Based on their outside tunnel ID coming in this case, we have tunnel IDs 1 and 2, they're going to get modified to the internal VLAN for Open vSwitch. So we're going to take that packet, strip off its GRE tunnel key, give its internal VLAN ID, and submit it on to table 10. Table 3, you'll see in there, is not used. Table 10 does an interesting thing. What that one has an interesting, if you notice in the third line under it, table 10, that says actions. And it says learn. What table 10 is going to do is going to inject a rule into table 20 to cause a return path so that when the VM responds to that packet, whatever that is, there's going to be a return path set into Open vSwitch flow table. It's basically when a packet comes in from an outside world, we're going to actually, at that time, cause a flow table entry to be created to allow the VM to respond and that send it back to the proper space. If we look at this as actually learning the MAC address from the GRE tunnel endpoint and the tunnel key ID, so we can wrap all that correctly into it and send it just to the proper GRE tunnel endpoint, not to all GRE tunnel endpoints, to minimize our traffic. So this one will cause a rule to be entered in Open vSwitch, and it sets a timeout of 300 seconds. 300 seconds is what? 5 minutes? Remember how that ARP request was going to stay active before it goes stale was 60 seconds? Well, it guarantees that if this rule will stay in there longer than that ARP table request. So if a VM goes and puts a broadcast out with ARP request, that response from the ARP request is going to cause the return from that machine to be populated in Open vSwitch so the VM can continue to communicate and that rule will stay in there for 5 minutes. It will last longer than the local machine's ARP request. So we guarantee that the rule stays in place for a VM trying to talk to something. The return packet comes in, we know how to talk. And lastly, table 20, long table, what that one does, again, has actions, depending on what it's going to do. It's going to guarantee that unicast packets are sent to their proper spot. And if we look at table 21, similarly, and if you notice also that that very first rule in table 20 that I have up there is one of the rules that got populated by a packet having come in from the outside. That you look at a lot of the similar information, but you see where it's added in the very first one, it says VLAN TCI. It learned the VLAN it came in. It also learned the MAC address it came in from, and it learned the tunnel ID that it came in on. So it populates a rule that guarantees that packet will go to the proper MAC address of the one destination point it needs to do for the GRE tunnel endpoint and gets encapsulated the proper tunnel key. Lastly, channel table 21 handles broadcast packets. In this case, I have not turned on L2 population, and that means that broadcast packets will be sent to all GRE tunnel endpoints for that network. And so this handles broadcast packets. I don't have time to go in deeply into open vSwitch rules, and I'm going to run out of time if I'm not careful, so we need to go on. I know there's lots of questions. Read the manual. It turns out that actually in the open vSwitch, the OFCTL man page has a lot of good information about reading the open flow rules. Spend some time there. It will be your friend, and you'll be well served by learning that. A slide real quick. If you want to set up a mirror for open vSwitch, you can create the pair with the IP link, add, and then you can set one of the endpoints up. You can add that vEth pair then into the bridge, integration bridge. And then the next command actually sets the bridge. So what this is going to do is cause the packets that go on port ETH1, patch tunnel, and BRINT, those bridges, and the last line where it says create mirror, it's going to say the source those and all those from the destination, those packets are going to be reflected into my output port, which is one end of my vEth pair. Then I can set up TCP dump to listen on that other end of that vEth pair, which would be vEth1, which is outside open vSwitch, and I would see all the traffic going into and out of those ports. And you can lather, rinse, and return, or you can change the ports as appropriate. But this one will set it up, and then the last one will allow you to clear that bridge out of it. A command that a lot of folks are not aware of, it's very useful, is called the Neutron debug command. Neutron debug command is documented in the CLI manual. I'm not going to spend much time on it. Where it's handy is I can actually spin up a DHCP namespace and a probe namespace without having to spin up a VM, which can be real handy to check out Neutron's basic functionalities without having to try to spin up a VM. It's a way of testing, is my Neutron piece working right before I bring up a VM? It also has another command here called ping all, which allow me to ping, or I can ping every known VM that I have for a particular tenant, or I can add a particular namespace, network ID, and just ping all the assigned addresses inside a particular namespace. It'll come back, and it's a way of testing communication. Now, realize Neutron debug is a supershell of the Neutron command. So if you type in Neutron debug space help, you're going to see all the 140 some odd Neutron commands plus the debug commands. So you're going to find that's probably not helpful to do that. You're probably going to need to feed that and grep it on probe or ping to see what you want to see for the Neutron debug commands. But the CLI manual documentation does support that. To troubleshoot Neutron, there's some things that we need to do. And we need to do before we jump in. We need to go figure out the MAC addresses and IP addresses of our various VMs that are involved. Why? Because again, layer 2, layer 3 communication lets us to see what's going on here. We need to know what the DHCP server and router IP address and MAC addresses are. That way, when we do TCP dump on the packets, we'll know what's coming and going where. Also, from any our data network nodes. In other words, if we're using GRE tunnels or VLANs or VXLANs, what are these endpoint IPs that they should be communicating on. I strongly recommend when you configure Open vSwitch that you separate your data plane and your control plane. Makes life easier, keeps your data traffic separated from your control traffic, but also allows us to look at the purely the data plane traffic alone. We need to look at, is this a problem universal across my Open vSwitch we're having? Is it located to one tenant? What protocols are being used? Again, like I talked about, even basic communication will use broadcast and multicast packets. What's going on? Is this an L2 or an L3 problem? Well, if I spin up a VM and doesn't get an IP, it's an L2 problem because I haven't set up the basic L2 communication. So we need to look at that. Examine, locate. We need to look carefully what's happened and take time to troubleshoot through, be very careful through this. We typically don't spend time there. And then we need to isolate it to a tenant, a network, a VM, or a compute or network node. Where is the problem going and where is it broke? At that point, once we've collected data, consider the causes. We may find we need more data, go through the process again. Again, what are the solutions? Test. And only at that time we start adjusting things. And one thing at a time, folks, resist the temptation. I know every time I succumb to this temptation, oh, that was, I know what it is now, and I start adjusting. I know when I do that, it's the wrong thing. And sure enough, I prove it every time, it's the wrong thing. One thing at a time, go back. Keep a log of what you've tried. That's real important too, because I tend not to keep logs. I'm sloppy in that regard. And then I get down this process. What is it? I'll find out I've tried the same thing two or three times before I'm getting old, my memory goes, and you know those things happen. But keep a log. It makes your life easier. A couple other things before we look at example. One more slide here, and then we'll get into the example. I've got a few minutes to do that. Traffic levels. One of the things that Open vSwitch supports is S-flow. And network nodes can get trapped into too much traffic. Setting traffic data to S-flow connector is real helpful and things we can watch for. So at that point, let's look at, let me shrink this down. Let's look at a real VM here. I'm going to come in here. I have a VM right there. I'm going to go into that. Hopefully, it will work there. We can go see. We come down to the bottom of this. You can see I'm logged into Cirrus. I get into this, and I do an IPA. And look what happens here. No IP. We've all been there. So I'm going to do a sudo su dash. I know this is a thing everybody tells you not to do, but we're going to do it here. We're going to do a udhcp here, and I'm going to do a dash uppercase T for 1 second. Second time, I'm going to dash A, 1 second. And what this is going to do is going to go out and send DHCP request packets on my network. While I'm doing that is let's then go to the compute node, which will be this machine right here. I'm going to go to my compute node. Let's do a TCP dump. Let's back up. Let's do an IPA, look at what we have here. And I'm going to go to this interface right here, collect that, because that's the interface that's plugged into Open vSwitch. I'm going to do a TCP dump. I like the dash E option because that allows me to see the layer 2 communication going. Get that one. And if we watch it, sure enough, we see broadcast packets only going out from our VM, but no return, which is not surprising. That's kind of what we expect in this case. So TCP dump says what's going on. Let's do something else. Let's do a watch. I'm going to do an OVS-OFCTL on dump flows. Thank you. I wasn't watching what I was typing here. If I can type today. Now, why would I do this? Well, let me show you one of the things that happens. When you dump the tunnel of the flows, we can't see them all, but if you notice that my duration and my number of packets number, so now I can see what flows are that packet's hitting. Now, if I scroll through and get it bigger where we can see it all, you can see all the flows. But if you look at right here, in this line right here, which is the broadcast one, I see my packets line incrementing. Now, if I watch very carefully in rules one, and remember up in table one and table two, I said some of those, table one is going to be the packets coming out from my VMs, and table two is going to be my packets coming back. None of my table two stuff ever increments. So I know my packets are going out bridge tunnel and open vSwitch, nothing's coming back. So let's kill this. And if we really want to do one more thing here, just to look at it, we can look at, I think ETH1 is my, and sure enough, ETH1 is my packets going out. You can see the packets going, leaving open vSwitch, leaving my compute node, and yet nothing coming back. You can see those are boot DHCP requests. And you can also see the fact that it tells me that's a GRE tunnel packet with a key of one, which is what I expect. Okay, so things are working there the way I'd expect it. Let's come in, let's look at the network node. I think that is that this one here? Yep. Okay, so let's do a TCP dump, dash N, dash E, dash I on ETH1. See, the packets are coming in. Yep, they're coming in. Good. Now we can do the similar type thing we did before. We can do an OVS, let's do a watch. I want to hit the equal key there. I can do that and watch the packets come in. And sure enough, I watch the counter there. I can see the packets coming into it. I can see them matching the various rules. Looks like what's happening there should be. So let's go into here. So let's do an IPnet NS. Let's get our network namespace here. Let's grab that. And then let's grab that. And then let's look at my IP addresses inside that network namespace. I'm going to see this tap interface. Let me grab that. And so let's then come back. Oops, there, let's hit the right key. TCP dump. Now, when you're working inside a network namespace, use the dash L option. If you don't, you'll start it and you'll see no packets. Then you do a control C and then all the packets show. If you want them to show in real time, you need to use the dash L option. And we'll grab that right there. And we watch, and sure enough, wait a minute, the DHCP packets are coming in. My DHCP server should be running. Let's see what's going on here. So let's check something. If I do a PSAUX, grep for DNS mask for that. No DNS mask process running. Well, DNS process is mask process in my DHCP server. Let's try something here. Restart the DHCP agent process. Now let's go inside my network namespace and see what's happening here. Well, I'm not getting any traffic. Why not? Well, I'll show you why not. We see ARP requests, so that's a good sign. Let's go back in here and look at my machine here. Oops, it got its IP, which is why the DHCP, as soon as that UDHCP process gets its IP, it stopped. So in this case, we took a situation where I could not spin up a VM, could not get an IP. We tracked the request packet through Neutron to the endpoint. We saw that it wasn't getting a DHCP process address because why? Well, the service wasn't running. We restart the agent, we get the service up, we get an IP address. Simple, right? Yeah, we know how Neutron works sometimes. We're about the time, I think we're over time. I need to cut it off here, he says. He's gonna drag me off stage. Hopefully this is useful to you. Hopefully you see a few of the basics of troubleshooting Neutron. We went through a real life process, and I appreciate your time. If you have questions, come on down. I'll answer some in the front here what I can, and because they're gonna have to set up for the next person.